He uses gifts, his spiritual gifts for preaching. He uses spiritual gifts for how he leads. But he wouldn't have been able to be present here if you had not shared your financial gifts. He gets paid by the Iowa Annual Conference. And the only way that the Iowa Annual Conference has any resources is that local churches support that through our apportionments. Most of folks do not have a clue, unless you're involved in the Iowa Annual Conference in lots of detail, realize what our gifts do and how they're shared across the connection in not just in Iowa, but in the wider community, but also comes back to us. So today we're going to, last week we were going to talk about witness, and this week we're going to talk about service. So the 1 Corinthians passage, you're going to wonder, what does that have to do with witness? What is all this food stuff all about? Well, Jews used to offer sacrifices to God, to the one God. They offered sacrifices. They slaughtered the bulls, they slaughtered the calves, they slaughtered the sheep, the goats. They offered sacrifice. But so did other traditions offer sacrifice. So he's saying there's a couple of different things going on here. Like, you know for sure that the meat that they just slaughtered over there for some idols has nothing to do with idols, and it's perfectly good meat. You can go over, you can go buy that meat. You can eat it, and it means nothing. You know that in your head. You know that. But other people who may not be clear about the rules and so on may see you, a good follower of Christ, of this way, will see you going to the temple to get the meat, and you may cause them to stumble. Paul's saying, I know that it's okay for me to eat that meat. I know it. But out of love, because I may cause someone else to stumble, I'd rather become a vegetarian than to cause someone else to stumble. But there's also another part of this. Not everyone could afford to buy meat. And in the early church, they met in homes. Churches weren't built yet. They met in homes. And those homes were served by deacons. Usually women. And they would, after you worship, you would have a potluck. Well, some of the people were bringing lots of meat to those potlucks, but not everyone could afford to bring meat. In fact, they remembered what it was like in the temple. Remember Jesus' mother and father, Mary and Joseph? What did they bring to the temple? They brought two turtle doves. That was the cheapest form of sacrifice because they were poor. So you could tell who was rich and who was poor based on what you were, well, you could afford to sacrifice. And Paul was saying that becomes a stumbling block between the rich and the poor. Custom. It was a custom. It wasn't a tradition. It was a cultural custom that would get in the way of experiencing God's love. Cultural norms are not church traditions. When I was doing my clinical pastoral education, in other words, for chaplaincy work, at St. Luke's in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, I did it for a whole year. I got 2 units. It was a great experience. But sometimes I was there 4 or 5 days a week. Sometimes I had the night shift. And if I was there at night, I was to go visit people that were going to have surgery, which isn't quite, nowadays, 22, 23 years later, people are not in there the night before unless something is really serious. And in this particular case, it really was. So I went to look for Jack. Jack wasn't his name, though. I went to look for Jack, and I found Jack in the gathering room. There was where there's TV and puzzles and so on. And I introduced myself. I'm Reverend Linda. I am a chaplain here. I understand that you are having surgery tomorrow. Would you like me to pray with you? His first words out of his mouth were, "Women can't be pastors." And I said, "Oh." I just said, "Oh." And then he started to quote Paul and tell me again, "Women are not supposed to be pastors." And I just simply said, "So I've heard." That's all I said. "So I've heard. So I've heard. So tell me about yourself, Jack." "Tell me about." And Jack talked and talked and talked about disappointments in his life, how he had hoped to be a pastor, how he had been turned down in the denomination in which he was raised, how he had gone through divorce, how his whole life had followed a different path than he had expected. And after about a half an hour, guess what he asked me to do? He asked me to pray. I was his pastor. I was his pastor. Didn't matter about the cultural norms that he had been raised up in his church. It had to do with he was a witness. He was a witness to God's love. Second, about customs. I used to be a smoker. I didn't start smoking until I was, I did smoke when I was 16. Started smoking just a little, cool. And then I started smoking when I was 25. I was still smoking when I came to Iowa as a pastor. Now, smoking's not a sin. I mean, it used to be, it's morally, but it was a sin against my body. But I did not stop smoking because of my health reasons for not smoking. I stopped smoking because I hated the feeling of sneaking into Casey's, and I was so afraid one of the young ones, like a 13-year-old, would see me buying cigarettes and see me smoking, and therefore I would be a stumbling block. I hated the feeling. And then my friend invited me to be a camp counselor at Pictured Rock with her. And so I thought, I have got to stop smoking. I can't, a whole week at camp, I'm either gonna be totally miserable not smoking, or I'll be totally miserable sneaking around hoping none of the young ones see me smoking. So I finally went to the doctors. They gave me the medication, Butrin or Zyban or one of those things, and that you take it for 10 days, and on the 10th, and you can smoke, by the way, in those 10 days. So I did, and on the 10th day, I stopped smoking, and I never missed it. I never missed it. 2 weeks later, the camp was canceled. And I was not a smoker. Now, I first did it out of love for others rather than love for myself. I did it because I didn't want to be a stumbling block. Now, did it make any difference? Does it make any difference in the scheme of life whether I smoke or I don't smoke? Not really. For my body, yes, but not really. It's the same thing of lots of cultural norms. And in the 1 Corinthians reading for today, which we didn't read, Paul talks about being all things for all people, meaning that in the context in which he was serving, he did different things, not because they were made that much difference with God at all. It didn't make any difference, but it made a difference in the relationship in the community, which brings us to today's gospel reading, which has to do with service. So witness is not about, I have thought of witness as being somebody, an expert witness on the witness stand, or I have a picture over here someplace. You know, this is what I picture of when I think of sometimes of Christian witnesses, somebody with a bullhorn and saying, idolaters, liars, you're going to burn with fire and brimstone. Well, no. It's the gentle witness. It's the gentle witness of Jack. It's that gentle witness. It's about being present. And that's what the gospel reading's about. We are witnesses when we serve. For many years, reading this scripture, here is Peter's mother-in-law has been sick for I don't know how long, been sick for a while, and what is the first thing she does after she's healed? She gets up and she serves. Now, there have been a few times and I've said, oh, come on, give me a break. Doesn't she get any rest? But the word for serve is the same word, diakonos, deacon. She was the deacon of that house church. And she was made well in order to serve. Salvation means wholeness, not just wholeness for heaven, but wholeness now. We are healed, we are witnessed to, we are healed so that we can serve one another. And that is the good news. All of us, as Henry Nouwen said, are wounded healers. We've all been wounded. And it's usually out of that very woundedness, that very experience, I have a great deal of patience and understanding for addiction because I know how addicted I was to cigarette smoking. I was blessed that it was so easy. I never expected it to be easy. I think one of the primary reasons why I never stopped was because I didn't want to be a failure. I didn't want to have that cycle of failure, of trying and trying. But that's what it is really about, is the witness and the service. So where are you called? Where are we called to be in service, in love? What are some of the cultural norms that you recognize as potentially being in conflict? What are some of the cultural norms that may be in conflict with God's ethic of love? For each one of you, it may be something different. For each one of you, it may be something that you need to like accept. Just like I accepted where Jack was. I accepted where he was, and he accepted me because he needed me to be there. So where is that at? Where are you called? Amen. Did Desi forget to come and sit on my lap? As we come to a time of prayer, let us go into a time of silence as we gather all of our joys, our prayers of thanksgiving, our prayers of concern, our pleas, our laments. Are there any blue prayer cards this morning? Okay, are there any joys or prayers of thanksgiving for this morning? Right behind you, Mary.
Thank you. I just wanted everyone to know that, and many of you know my older daughter, Monica, and how she has had problems. She's been married for quite a while, and she and her husband have been trying to have a baby. She is pregnant. She's 20 weeks along, due June 26th, and they found out that it was a boy, and everything is going well. So continue the prayers for her as she continues on this journey. Thank you.
Are there any other joys this morning? Jay, I think Ron needs a microphone back there. Jay, Don.
I called and talked to the Carmichaels this morning. Ron and Rita have had a long week last Monday. Rita had a new knee put in. She came home from Iowa City on Wednesday. On Thursday evening, Ron went to the hospital with an illness. He got home, I think, Friday evening then, and yesterday had a day of rest. Ashley's been home taking care of him, and when I called this morning, Ron had went out to get the paper. Rita said he was feeling good, and she was about to start her exercises and going ahead with her knee project. So things are going much better out there, but please keep them in your prayers if you would. Thank you.
The flowers this morning are from Marcia Taylor's father's funeral, celebration of life for David Smith. That was yesterday at St. John's Lutheran Western Douglas in rural Plainfield. So thanks for the plant, Marcia. And continued prayers for your family and large family. Many, many cousins. Many, like 43.
Well, 51 on the Smiths.
Oh, 51!
One has disease.
So continued prayers during your grieving time. Also, continued prayers for Darlene Krug. Last Sunday, she was doing super, super well over the past few days. She's been up mingling in the lunchroom with people, eating. So if you all want to come and worship with us at 1:30 today, you may be able to see her. So we'll be at Sunnycrest today at 1:30. Are there any other prayers for healing, concerns, surgeries coming up, that sort of thing? Be a witness.
I just wanted to let you guys know how Grandma Louise Bruce is doing. She is at Sunrise Hill Care Center in Traer. She's getting along pretty well over there. She likes it okay, I guess, for now. It's been very difficult on our family not to have her with us all the time. So just, I guess, prayers for Grandma that she continues to just, I guess, do better each day. She is doing therapy. And then a lot of prayers for my mom. This has been very difficult on her also. So just wanted to have you keep her in your prayers too.
I'm so glad to have you here this morning. Any others? Then let us pray. Holy One, we celebrate that you are our one great God, creator of all things and all time. Yet we know there are those who hunger and suffer in our world. Help us to give from our from our privilege so that all might share in the wealth of your abundant love. Help us to use our education, our abilities, our skills toward the healing of your world. Teach us to see the beauty of a soul. Give us eyes to behold the grace of kindness and mercy and generosity. And help us to recognize the value of hard work and to celebrate the health we enjoy will also be enjoyed by our planet when we use more effort in our days. Holy One, we thank you for the ways you mend our broken spirits, mend our communities and our planet. And we pray for your wisdom and healing. Be with all who suffer and are oppressed. And help us to use the energy we would put into worshiping false gods towards sharing love and compassion with others. Amen. So let us now offer our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings so that we can be the witness and servants of God's love.
Thank you.
Please join with me. We give in celebration of our one true and great God. May our wealth be a gift to God. May our successes be held up as honor to God. May our beauty be experienced in every gesture of love and kindness we ever share. And may our willingness to work a little harder be seen by God as our devotion to God's world and wisdom. Gracious God, bless these our offerings, we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. When we fear poverty,
help us to trust in the power of community.
When we fear rejection,
help us to know our value and worth deep within us.
When we fear hunger and thirst,
help us to give thanks for the bread and cup before us each day.
When we fear solitude,
help us to reach out in love to others in need.
And when we fear our own pain and death,
help us to reach out in our need for sustenance of others.
Holy One, forgive us our fears. Help us return to the ways of your grace and forgive us our worship of other gods. Amen. And hear these good words. God has created us in community and communion with one another. Let us look to each other and see the one true God that has created us all and invites us to live in harmony and peace. Let us be assured that when the other gods we entertain fail us, our loving God